chapter 3.4, he brought us out to bring us in. Deuteronomy 6, verse 22 to 23. Moreover, the Lord showed great and distressing signs and wonders before our eyes against Egypt, Pharaoh, and all his household. And he brought us out from there in order to bring us in, to give us the land which he had sworn to our fathers. Deuteronomy 6, verse 22 to 23. Number one, no man's land. The Lord ministered to me this word on Tuesday, 26 February 2013, at 7 a.m. This was on our second wedding anniversary. It was very certain that the Lord had taken me out of Egypt. He had taken me out of slavery, bondage, and captivity. That Pharaoh was no longer part of my life was an unquestionable reality. That Laban no longer had any hold over my life and family was as real as my right hand. The very things I had yearned God to deliver me from, had been blotted out of my memory. I was my own boss and slowly developing into a nation. There was, however, a vacuum in my life. The comfort of deliverance was not enough to fill this void. Yes, I had been delivered from Egypt, but I had not yet been delivered into the promised land. I was in no man's land. I still carried that reproach, and that reproach would only be removed the day I would lay hold of the promises of God. 2 Peter 1 verse 3 to 4. No man's land is a place between two borders. One can be there on his way to or from the promised land. No one owns this land. This is a deciding period in your life. You really need spiritual muscle to move out of this position in life. While I wondered about all this, the Lord then dropped his word in my spirit. He brought us out to bring us in. That is when I realized that God had a purpose when he delivered me from Egypt, and that purpose was to see me through to his promises, no matter what. Number two, God has a purpose. Hebrews 6 verse 4. The Lord does not just take us out of situations and leave us hanging. His ultimate goal and purpose is to bring us into a place of promise, the promised land. So as to keep us humble and stop us from remembering, the Lord has to be remembered as the Lord who took us out of Egypt, a place of slavery and bondage. He would always announce himself to the children of Israel as the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, who delivered them out of the land of Egypt. Judges 6 verse 8 to 9. We cannot have an appreciation of the real love of God if we are not constantly reminded of how he delivered us and brought us out of slavery and bondage to bring us in the promised land. The promised land was described then as a place flowing with milk and honey, but in the New Testament era, to accommodate the work, the cross, it is described as a place where we are, in Hebrews 6 verse 4, enlightened and have a taste of the heavenly gift, and made partakers of the Holy Spirit, and have a taste of the good word of God and the powers of the age to come. Hebrews 6 verse 4. It is a place we need to dwell and maintain lest we fall back and are deported to Babylon, where, as the scripture continues and says, and then have fallen away, it is impossible to renew them again to repentance, since they again crucify to themselves the Son of God and put to him to open shame. Verse 6. Once God has redeemed us, we have to maintain our testimony of having been delivered. The enemy of our lives will devour us if we ever turn back. God will not be pleased if we turn back from the faith. Hebrews 10 verse 38 says, "But my righteous one will live by faith, and if he shrinks back, I will not be pleased with him." The promised land is a place of faith. Only those with enough faith will inherit and maintain it. God will not be pleased if we lose our faith. Our faith is in his Son Jesus Christ, who overcame the devil, that he may dwell in us through the work of the Holy Spirit. Number 3. Power shift. Deuteronomy 9 verse 1 to 6. What Moses and Joshua realized as God took them towards the promised land was that it was already occupied by other people. The Lord was bringing the children of Israel in and at the same time driving out the nations before them. We are taught therefore that that what we desire is currently in the hands of other people. There has to be a power shift, an exchange program from those other people and nations to us. As we discussed in the earlier message, the Lord explained the real reason why he would perform the power shift. The Lord does not and does this not because of our righteousness, Deuteronomy 9 verse 5, but because 1. He has chosen us by grace and has a plan and purpose for our lives. Number 2. The sins and iniquities of his enemies. Number 3. For his name's sake. Number 4. His oath and promises to our fathers. The power of the new covenant, Hebrews 8 verse 7. We obviously have a role to play in this whole power shift exercise. We have to believe in God that he will fulfill his promises. We need to not murmur and complain during this process, but continue trusting him and his leadership. Number 4. What is God bringing us into? Hebrews 4 verse 8 to 9. Paul taught the events of Exodus and the conquest are meaningful for Christians in that those events possess significance as types. 1 Corinthians 10 verse 1 to 11 says, "Now these things happened to them as an example, and they were written for our instruction, upon whom the ends of the ages have come." 1 Corinthians 10 verse 1 to 11. The Greek form of the name Joshua, Yahweh saves, or Yahweh is salvation, is Jesus. As Joshua led Israel to victory over her enemies and into possession of the promised land, and as he interceded for the nation after it had sinned and been defeated, so does Jesus Christ. He brings the people of God into a promised rest. Hebrews 4 verse 8 to 9 says, "For if Joshua had given them rest, he would not have spoken of another day after that. There remains therefore a Sabbath rest for the people of God." God wants us to enter his rest. For the Israelites of Moses' time, this rest was the earthly rest to be found in the promised land. For Christians, it is peace with God, now and eternal life on a new earth later. We do not need to wait for the next life to enjoy God's rest and peace. We may have it daily now. Our daily rest in the Lord will not end with death, but will become an eternal rest in the place that Christ is preparing for us. John 14 verse 1 to 2 says, "Do not let your heart be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many dwelling places. If it were not so, I would not have told you, for I go to prepare a place for you." John 14 verse 1 to 2. Jesus' words show that the way to eternal life, though unseen, is secure as your trust in Jesus. He has already prepared the way to eternal life. The only issue that may still be unsettled in our is your willingness to believe. There are a few verses in the Bible that Jesus talks about eternal life. But these few verses are rich with promises. Here Jesus says in verse 3, I go to prepare a place for you, and I will come again. We can look forward to eternal life because Jesus has promised it to all who believe in him. Although the details of eternity are known, we need not fear because Jesus is preparing for us and will spend eternity with us. Number 5, how will God bring us into his rest? Romans 8 verse 34. Like Joshua interceded for the children of Israel and defeated their enemies, Jesus intercedes for his own continually and has fought our enemies. So we are guaranteed to enter his rest through his continuous and unceasing intercession for us. Romans 8:34 says, who is the one that condemns? Christ Jesus is he who died, yes, rather who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who also intercedes for us. Romans 8:34. In order for us to enter his rest, we need an intercessor. Paul says that Jesus is interceding for us in heaven. Heaven is a place where we ought to be. So in the same manner, Abraham being in the promised land, first before the children of Israel, was the perfect intercessor for them. Genesis 15 verse 16. The Lord told him that he would bring his descendants to the place he was standing. Similarly, Jesus' intercession is like Abraham's preparation of the land the children of Israel would years later yearn to be. Jesus is in heaven preparing a place for us. A true prophet cannot take people where he has not been. Moses could not take the children of Israel through the wilderness for 40 years because he had been there for 40 years. Jesus would take us into his rest for eternity because he is in eternity. God has acquitted us and has removed our sin and guilt, so it is Satan, not God, who accuses us. When he does, Jesus, the advocate for our defense, stands at God's right hand to present our case. My advocate, witness, and judge. Job 16 verse 18 to 22. Hebrews 7 verse 25 says, therefore he is able also to save forever those who draw near to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them. Hebrews 7 verse 25. No one can add to what Jesus did to save us. Our past, present, and future sins are all forgiven, and Jesus is with the Father as a sign that our sins are forgiven. If you are a Christian, remember that Christ has paid the price for your sins once and for all. Hebrews 9 verse 24 to 28. Number 6. Our enemy is dispossessed. Hebrews 2 verse 14 to 15. As our Joshua, Jesus enables us to dispossess our enemies. Romans 8:37 says, but in all these things we overwhelmingly conquer through him who loved us. As we are approaching our promised land, it is important to know that Christ will enable us to conquer our enemies. It is because of the unbreakable love of Christ that he has already gone ahead of us to fight for us. We will overcome. Hebrews 2 verse 14 to 15 says, therefore, since the children share in flesh and blood, he himself likewise also partook of the same, that through death he might render powerless him who had the power of death, that is, the devil, and might free those who through fear of death were subject to slavery all their lives. Hebrews 2 verse 14 to 15. Christ's death and resurrection set us free from the fear of death because death has been defeated. Our greatest enemy was death. This was the last standing enemy, just as the Philistines were the last standing enemy in Israel. But just as David plunged the stone into Goliath's head, so did Christ crush the head of the serpent. He was the seed of the woman that would crush the head of the serpent. The head of the serpent, that which gave him power, was death. Christ died because of sin. Our sins were put on him, so the devil laid a demand on him through Judas and had him nailed on the cross. The victory was in that when he resurrected, it was a sign that he had defeated the curse of the enemy. In defeating death, because our sins were put on him, it means we also died and rose again with him. He became the firstborn from the dead, that you may become the second one, the third one, the fourth one, even the fifth, seventh born. Our enemy is dispossessed. We no longer fear death because Christ painted a prophetic picture of how we will also be delivered from dying eternally. Every person must die, but death is not the end. Instead, it is the doorway to a life and a new life. All who dread death should have the opportunity to know the hope that Christ's victory brings. He brought us out to bring us in. He brought us out of the mouth of the lion into his arms. The Lord ministered to me on May 24, 2013, that I needed to write this book as a testimony to the resurrection power. 1 Corinthians 2 verse 6 to 11. That death has lost its sting. The very thing that our enemy took pride in, Jesus Christ became our way of escape. The knowledge that Christ has conquered on our behalf is the knowledge that Joshua and the Israelites gathered when the two spies reported back to Joshua that their enemies' hearts had melted away and the land was waiting for a takeover. They realized that they would fight a defeated enemy. It is the same with us today. Our spiritual intelligence informs us that our enemy is dispossessed. Number 7, preparation for the crossing. Joshua 3 verse 1 to 4. Joshua was a man of action. The spies having reported in, Israel's leader began immediate preparation to cross the Jordan and invade Canaan. As yet, Joshua had no knowledge of how this massive group of people was to cross the swollen river. Verse 15. But believing that God would somehow make it possible, he moved them all, bag and baggage. The 7 miles from Shittim to Jordan, Shittim is probably the same as Abel Shittim, Numbers 33 verse 49. Having arrived at the river, they stopped for 3 days. Time was no doubt needed for the leaders to organize the crossing and pass instructions to the people. The delay also gave everyone an opportunity to get close and see the river. Now a strong and rapid current due to the melting of the winter snows of Mount Hermon in the north. They must have faltered at the seeming impossibility of crossing. At the end of the third day of waiting, the people were given instructions. The pillar of cloud would no longer lead them, but they were instead to follow the Ark of the Covenant. No army scouts would advance first into the land, but rather priests bearing the Ark, verse 11. And since the Ark symbolized the Lord himself, it was Yahweh who led his people into Canaan. With the Ark going ahead, the people were to fall in behind, or possibly to spread around it on 3 sides. But they were to keep their distance by 3,000 feet. Why? Probably to remind them of the sacredness of the Ark and the holiness of the God it represented. They were to have no casual, careless intimacy with God, but a profound spirit of respect and reverence. God was to be considered not the man upstairs, but the sovereign and holy God of all the earth. The distance was also essential so that the largest possible number of this great population could see the Ark. God was about to lead them over unfamiliar ground. over a way they had not taken before. It was new territory, so without the Lord's guidance and leadership, the people would not know which direction to take. Number 8, consecration for the crossing. Joshua 3 verse 5 to 13. As the day for the crossing approached, Joshua commanded the people to sanctify or consecrate themselves. It would be easier to understand if he had said, "Sharpen your swords and check your shields." But spiritual, not military, preparation was needed at this time because God was about to reveal himself by performing a great miracle in Israel's midst. As a person would prepare scrupulously to meet someone of earthly fame, so it was appropriate for the Israelites to prepare for the manifestation of the God of all earth. The same command was heard at Sinai when the previous generations prepared itself for the majestic revelation of the Lord in the giving of the law. Exodus 19 verse 10 to 13. But that was not all. The people of Israel were to expect God to work a miracle. They were to be eager, gripped by a sense of wonder. Israel was to lose sight of their God, who can do the incredible and humanly impossible. The Lord then told Joshua how they would make the crossing and explained to Joshua that this miracle would magnify or exalt him as the leader of the people. It was time to establish Joshua's credentials as God's representative to guide Israel. What better way to accomplish this than for Joshua to direct their message through a miraculous parted river? After the crossing, the people did in fact revere Joshua in Joshua 4 verse 14. Knowing that God was with him, Joshua 3 verse 7, Joshua 1 verse 5, Joshua 1 verse 9. But when Joshua passed on the word of God to the people, he did not disclose the special promise that he would be exalted by this miraculous event. Rather, he told them that this miracle would satisfy that the living God, in contrast with the dead idols worshipped by the heathen, was in their midst. Further, besides opening a way across the flooded Jordan, the living God would also drive out the seven groups of the people inhabiting the land. The promise, "The living God is among you," became the watchword of the conquest, the key to victory over the enemies in the land. It is a promise that appears on almost every page of this book. "I will be with you." It is a promise that still sustains the Lord's people, the assurance of his presence. Since God is the Lord, Adon, Master of all the earth, Psalms 97 verse 5, he was certainly capable of getting his people across a river. Number 9, completion of the crossing. Joshua 3 verse 14 to 17. The day of the crossing of the Jordan, the day when Israel was to enter Canaan, finally arrived. The people folded their tents and followed the ark bearing priests to the brink of the Jordan. It was the time for the barley harvest, the month of Nisan, March or April, the first month of their year. Joshua 4 verse 19. The river was at flood stage, a foreboding sight to the priests and the people, and a severe test of their faith. Would they hesitate in fear, or would they advance in faith, believing that what God had promised would actually happen? Dramatic things happened the moment the priest carrying the Ark of the Covenant stepped into the muddy, swelling waters. The water from upstream stopped flowing, verse 18, piling up at a town called Adam. Waters from other streams were completely cut off, so as not to enter the Jordan. So the people crossed over opposite Jericho. This is the reminiscent of the Red Sea crossing, Exodus 15 verse 8, Psalm 78 verse 13. A wide stretch of riverbed therefore was dried up, allowing the people with their animals and baggage to hurry across. Joshua 4 verse 10. Many supernatural elements were brought together. 1. The event came to pass as predicted. Joshua 3 verse 13. Joshua 3 verse 15. The timing was exact in verse 15. 3. The event took place when the river was at flood stage. Verse 15. 4. The wall of water was held in place for many hours, possibly an entire day. Verse 16. 5. The soft, wet riverbed became dry at once. Verse 17. 6. The water returned immediately as soon as the people had crossed over and the priests came up out of the river. Joshua 4 verse 18. Centuries later, the prophets Elijah and Elisha crossed the same river on dry ground to the east. 2 Kings 2 verse 8. Soon thereafter, Elisha crossed back over the river on dry ground. If a natural phenomenon is necessary to explain the Israelites crossing under Joshua, then one would have to conclude that two earthquakes occurred in quick sequence for Elijah and Elisha, which seems a bit presumptuous. By this great miracle, the crossing of the Jordan River at flood stage by a nation of about 2 million people, God was glorified. Joshua was exalted. Israel was encouraged. And the Canaanites were terrorized. For Israel, the crossing of the Jordan meant they were irrevocably committed to a struggle against armies, chariots, fortified cities. They were also committed to walk by faith in the living God and to turn from walking according to the flesh as they had often done in the wilderness. For believers today, crossing the Jordan represents passing from one level of the Christian life to another. It is not a picture of a believer dying and entering heaven. For the Israelites, Canaan was hardly heaven. It is a picture of entering into spiritual warfare to claim what God has promised. This should mean the end of a life lived by human effort and the beginning of a life of faith and obedience in God. Amen.